Bye. I'm on? Great. All right, guys. We are going to get ready to get started. Since we have a very limited amount of time, I want to start on time. They gave me the big room so I can look bad and not have a lot of, no, I'm joking. I'm glad to have you guys here, but this is about schools. And so in the fashion of schools, I'm gonna ask everyone to sit in these two sections around six or seven rows back. If you could just humor me so I can feel like I'm talking in this small group breakout session like it's intended to be. So I'll give you enough time to run back to your seat so when those other people come in for the next session, they're not taking your seats. But if you could just come into these two sections, we're going to make this a little bit more of an intimate workshop gathering. But yes, for those who just came in, I'm asking everyone to sit in these two sections. Since this is a small breakout session, I want us to kind of feel like we're in a smaller room. So first of all, thank you guys. I'm assuming I don't have to introduce myself again. Hopefully you were in the earlier session. I will give you a little bit more information about me in case you weren't able to read the program. As I said, I'm a clinical psychologist by training, and I've trained in a number of settings. I worked in school settings, school health clinics, as well as working in hospitals, so community health settings, a number of different settings, and really in justice settings, of course. I said I worked at Rikers. I usually tell people I had my first run-in with the law at Rikers and just wait to see what they're going to say about me. But I was training at Rikers. So I've done a lot of these different things, but one of the areas that for me is just so important is the schools and how do we understand trauma-informed practice in schools? Because being in a school can be really, really difficult to kind of take all of these different concepts and distill them into a single type of presentation. And so what I want to do is I want us to talk about what it means to be trauma-informed within the school setting. And, you know, thinking about you all as clinicians, how you might integrate some of this with the work that you're doing in your respective settings and kind of how you're bolstering the parents and other people that you might have contact with who are interacting with the children who are in our settings. But before we start, I'd like to give a quick perspective of why some of our teachers may be stressed out. Can we hit the clip? No, I'm going to have to act out this whole thing. No, the children. So this is from Kindergarten Cop, and this is when he goes into the classroom, and for the first time, this actually might be because my flash drive isn't in there, so it doesn't have the embedded video. It's okay. You guys imagine. Give a good belly laugh like you just saw it. Ha, ha, ha. Nobody's with me. All right, anyway, this video clip shows Arnold Schwarzenegger, and he's going into the class, and the kids are just running amok, and then he finally tells them to shut up, and they do what children do. They start crying, and he runs out of the classroom super stressed out. And so what we want to do today is we want to really, again, dive into what can be stressors for educators in the work that they do, and thinking about kind of a trauma-informed system. So at the National Child Traumatic Stress Network, we've developed this definition around what a trauma-informed system is. And I'll just briefly highlight a couple of pieces of these of this. And this is really for any system, whether it's child welfare, juvenile justice, or schools. First is to be able to recognize a response to traumatic stress reactions, regardless of who is impacted by it. So whether it's children, caregivers, teachers, service providers, being able to be aware of that. And then being able to have programs that both create awareness around some of these issues, but also builds people's skill set so that they can better manage what they're dealing with. And then finally, you want to see a collaboration between different groups and really being able to understand the science behind what promotes psychological safety. You're always striving for psychological safety because here's the key here. No matter how physically safe you make someone, if they're not psychologically safe, they'll still act to protect themselves. They'll still act as if a threat is present. And so part of what our goal is to bolster a sense of psychological safety among the children, their parents, and the community they're in. So just to give you a little overview of trauma and what it looks like in the school, this was a study that was done by the National Education Association a couple of years back. They found that 20 to 30% of surveyed teachers report teaching in either a very or extremely stressful environment. That's a good number. 30% of all novice teachers leave the profession before their fifth year. And then common stressors that they cited were, of course, heavy workload, salary, just not having the resources to be able to deal with a lot of what was happening with them. And what we understand is that there's an excessive amount of stress in their job can lead to burnout. How many people in here are familiar with the PROQL, the Professional Quality of Life questionnaire? Nobody? A couple people. This is actually a really great tool that I would encourage you to use. We use it in school settings. We use it in child welfare settings. It's free online. And what it does is it looks at three different areas as it relates to trauma, or as it relates to being burnt out. So it's burnout is one of them, secondary traumatic stress, which I'll define in a little bit, and then also compassion satisfaction. So kind of flipping this idea of compassion fatigue on its head and saying, are you being satisfied by the work that you do? Yes. It's called the Professional Quality of Life Scale, PROQL. Yep. Hey, feel free. Thank you. Breaking the ice. If you have a question, just raise your hand. It's fine. I don't mind stopping. So it's a great resource to use and to monitor, because you really look at the past 30 days in terms of how someone has been operating, and so it changes. It's dynamic because things can change as people are experiencing these things. So let's talk a little bit about reminders, triggers, and early warning signs. So in trauma-informed work, we generally conceptualize triggers or reminders as anything that reminds you of the traumatic experience that you've had or event. It's, you know, it's not a trick saying. It's anything that reminds you of that. And it can be things that are both conscious and unconscious. And so as you guys know, many clinicians in here, you know, these can be very clear things like avoiding someone who reminds you of the trauma, but also it can be hidden things, things like affection or getting close to someone. You know, as soon as you start to build a relationship, this person pushes away because in some way that connection is a reminder of a traumatic experience that they've had, or particularly at the hand of someone that they care about, so interpersonally. And the flip side of this is these triggers and reminders are setting off kind of that stress response we talked about earlier with the amygdala and the nervous system and the sympathetic system activating to fight, fly, or freeze. But the early warning signs are things that you are aware of that might be happening in your body or around you that are showing you that you're escalating to the point of crisis where this alarm is going to go off. And so, you know, this might be your stomach starting to hurt, or maybe you start feeling tension in your body in some way. Maybe sometimes people stop eating. I worked with a group of kids in detention, and we were trying to go over this idea of early warning sign. I said, what's an early warning sign? They were like, you shoot somebody. I was like, it's a little too late. It's a little too late. It's not a warning anymore. And so early is before the crisis hits. And so when we allow educators to better recognize their triggers and warning signs, it really gives them a chance to better feel like they have control over their environment. So here are some examples of some reminders and early warning signs. Again, a particular time of day could be something, specific person or a certain type of person, agitation, sweating, feeling tight in the chest. And again, the reason why it's important to become more aware of this, and I think particularly for you all as your role when it comes to schools or some of these other settings, child welfare, may not always be directly, you're doing the therapy itself, but sometimes you might be called in for consultation. How does a parent do X, Y, Z, or how does a teacher do X, Y, Z? And part of helping people who've experienced trauma get a sense of powerfulness or being empowered in some way, because trauma can be so disempowering, is giving them a sense of agency by being aware of what's going on with them. I always liken it to if you have a cough, right? If you have a cough that doesn't go away, if you're like me, you know, of course it's cancer, I'm going to die tomorrow. Right? That's the only option that it is. But then you go to your doctor, and your doctor is like, you know, actually, it's just a mild case of bronchitis, and, you know, we're going to give you some antibiotics, and you're going to be fine. Even before you take the medicine, after you leave the doctor's office, how do you feel? Feel better, right? Just because you know what's going on with you. Many times with our kids in schools, and sometimes with our teachers, they don't know why I feel so frustrated. Why when I go home, you know, I don't want to talk to my spouse or my kids, and I don't want to deal with things that are around me. Well, part of it is they have been experiencing trauma, or been exposed to people who have experienced trauma that have caused some of these experiences. So what we talked about, there's so many different types of trauma. I'm just giving you guys a buffet of trauma today. We talked earlier today about historical trauma and intergenerational trauma and individual trauma. Well, these are other forms of trauma that I'm sure we're very much familiar with in our field at this point. Vicarious trauma sometimes is used with compassion fatigue, and this focuses on when we feel like we can't show that same level of empathy because we've experienced or been exposed to so many stories of other people and their traumatic experiences. You know, I work in juvenile justice a lot, and I hear from a lot of the people who are working in these arenas that, you know, I've heard about so many kids who've been abused or molested, and it's just like, I hear it, and it's like, well, that's just life. And they start to have this perspective. Well, that's when vicarious trauma is starting to take an effect on them. Secondary traumatic stress is when you start to, when you're hearing these stories from kids and their traumatic stress reactions, whether it's hyper arousal because it's aggression or it's disassociation or just zoning out, mentally separating from the experience. Part of what we understand is that the individual can start having adverse reactions to it. The teacher themselves can start having, you as a clinician can start having some of these experiences. So you might have difficulty concentrating. You might not get as much enjoyment out of activities you used to get. You know, problems sleeping and eating. You're constantly thinking about some of these stories. Isolation, lower motivation. You might use unhealthy coping strategies, right? Happy hour turns to happy week. And it's just, you know, it doesn't end. You're just doing all these types of things. And so being able to think about how this is impacting their trajectory is tremendously important. Now, here's what we're going to really dig into today. That's kind of the preface of what we're going to talk about today. I think we learn best when we do stuff. So it won't just be me talking up here today. We're going to do some activities to help us think about some of these concepts that we're looking at. But I want to start by talking about self-care and identity. First of all, self-care. How many people in here practice it? I should see everyone's hands. Some people, they didn't even have the self-care to raise their hand. Come on. I'm hoping everyone in here practices self-care. But the thing about self-care that we should be aware of is that it's a very intentional practice. It's something that you have to put in your schedule, that you have to do on purpose. And it's not something that just comes about. I love the analogy of an airplane pilot, right? When an airplane pilot comes on before you go out, you know, start going in flight, they say your mask may come down. And what do they want you to do with your mask when it comes down? Put it on yourself first, right? Because you can't save someone else dead. You got to be alive to save people. And some of us are very dead in many ways in parts of our life, in different domains in our life in terms of how we're showing up in life because we haven't taken care of that part. But I want to dig into that concept a little bit more because sometimes we paint very broad strokes around self-care and what it means. But part of what we understand about stress and what stresses us is that it's very tied to what it is that we find important, the parts of us that we find salient. So here's what I mean. If you think that a big part of your identity and who you are is being a good son or a good daughter, and your parent or someone else tells you, you're just not cutting it, I want to talk to your brother or sister, right? That will cause you a lot of stress. But if that actually isn't a big part of your identity, a big part of how you conceptualize yourself, and someone says, you're an awful child, and you're like, have any parents? I don't care. Like that doesn't mean anything to me, and it doesn't have the same impact on you. And part of us being able to really engage self-care is being able to take stock in which parts of our identity are most salient to us and which parts of our identity are most important for us. And so as we think about this, part of being able to really take a strengths-based approach and to help others move in a place to manage stress is being able to help them identify which aspects of their identity are most salient and how do they really affirm those parts that are important to them. And so let's talk a little bit about how we can reshape or reframe some of the stressors in our life. And so part of what we understand is that when we become aware of these different aspects of our identity, what we have now, what I, as I explained earlier, is a sense of agency, the ability to kind of either reframe the way we're seeing our world around us, but also in a very targeted fashion, think about how to recharge those parts that have been depleted. So as I'm talking right now, I like to use a concept called the identity tank. And this refers to kind of your ability. This isn't any kind of scientific concept in the sense of this is a study construct, but I think it's a good way to conceptualize how we can recharge ourselves when certain domains of our life or functioning feel depleted. So I'm actually going to draw from a very different arena. If anyone has read Gary Chapman's book, Five Love Languages, has anyone read or heard of that book? A lot of people, okay. All the people with rings on their hand, I read it, I got this. So it's a really great book. It's a great book about understanding how to understand the way people want to be loved and how you like to be loved yourself in a romantic relationship. And part of what his concept is that people have these love tanks. And when those things aren't recharged, refilled, people feel depleted in the relationship. And I like to contend that it's similar for our self-care. We have these identity tanks. We have these parts of us that if they aren't recharged either by others or they're affirmed by us, then we fail to really engage in this ongoing self-care process. And really, it makes it more difficult for us to really give to others and really to pour into other people's life. And so part of what we can do is really think about how our identities play a role in the way that we manage stress and become more aware of this and from there be able to take action based on it. So you've already heard the buzzword that is going to pretty much be the foundation for the rest of what we're talking about today, and that's be aware. And when we talk about being aware, what concept are we generally talking about? I thought y'all going to finish my sentence. Mindfulness, right? We're generally talking about mindfulness because mindfulness is a tool that we have been growing and learning so much about from neuroscience perspective, from kind of evidence-based practice perspective in terms of how it increases a person's ability to be aware of what's happening in their life, what's happening within them, what's happening around them in a non-judgmental way that gives them more access to tools that they may not, within themselves, that they may not have been aware of before. All right. There's just one rule in all my mindfulness exercises. Don't go to sleep. All right? All right. So, first, if you are comfortable, I would ask you to either put your gaze downward or close your eyes, whichever you're more comfortable with. Don't worry, I'll stop all spitballs. It's like school. No one will throw any spitballs at you. So first, I really want you to take stock of your body and your breath. Taking a deep breath in, one, two, three, and out, three, two, one. Breathing in, one, two, three, and out, three, two, one. Just take a moment to take stock of where your body is right now, starting with your feet. Notice, are they tense? Are they relaxed? Moving up to your legs, notice how your legs are feeling right now. Moving up to your stomach, chest. Just notice, is it churning? Is it relaxed? What's happening with your stomach, your chest? Is it tight? If thoughts come up, just notice them and bring your attention back to your body. Bringing your attention back to your arms and your shoulders, just notice what they feel like right now. Finally, just bringing your attention to your neck, your head. Just notice where your body is right now. Now, I want you to think about the identity that means the most to you. Maybe it's a role in your family. Maybe it's a professional role. Maybe it's a hobby or an aspiration you have, something you're striving to do. Think about the identity that's most important to you. What are some of the emotions that come with thinking about this identity? Those visceral emotions that may make you feel affirmed, it may make you feel more stressed. Just notice whatever those feelings are without judging them, positive or negative. For anything, we have a story around it. So I want you to think about, what's your story around this identity for yourself, positive or negative? What is this identity mean in your life? How does it help you navigate the world? Think about what it will mean for your life to have increased awareness around this identity. Just think about maybe the next week, if you paid closer attention and were more mindful of this identity, how might it change the way you operate, the way you deal with the world? Keeping your eyes closed, I want you to think about and bring your attention and your awareness to a situation where that identity was part of what stressed you out. Maybe it was a situation that you were in recently, or it goes back a little further, but there was something that was impacted. Your identity in that arena was impacted in some way, and it stressed you out. So become aware of that. Now that you have a good idea around that, we're going to do something called the self-compassion meditation. Keeping your eyes closed, first I want you to just bring awareness to that moment of suffering and acknowledge that it's suffering, that that situation was difficult. Don't try to change it or rethink it, just acknowledging that that situation was difficult. Now, I want you to tell yourself, to think to yourself, that this suffering is not unique to just you. It might be a unique situation, but it's not unique to just you. And so in your own way, tell yourself suffering is a part of life, and bring that as a part of your awareness. Finally, I want you to think of someone in your life who supports you as a caregiver or a mentor. And even if you don't have that person, make someone up like that. And I want you to think about how you can be kind to yourself in this moment. And I want you to do that by really speaking to yourself in the third person. So I want you to think using pretending to be that person, pretending to be that mentor or whoever else, and say that you got through this, that you were able to push through these obstacles. And really, what I want you to do is show yourself the compassion that you often show others. I want you to talk to yourself in the way that you would talk to others for this situation. Taking a couple of deep breaths in, one, two, three, out, one, two, three, one more time, in, one, two, three, out, one, two, three. And when you're ready, you can bring your attention back into the room. All right. Would anyone like to share what their experience was like with that? Everyone stayed awake. I'm very glad about that. Yes. I'm gonna bring mics over.
I don't need a so loud. For real?
Just to help folks out, you know. So you don't have to be loud.
A little bit lower just in case I blow anybody's eardrums away. I just thought it was going to be a lot harder than I thought it was, but I've been trying to practice a lot more mindfulness. Mm-hmm. I run a mindful movement group for my kids at the clinic. And I was thinking, I haven't done like a visualization for myself, just for me.
Yeah.
I was like, I don't think I'm gonna be able to do it. How am I gonna talk to myself in third person? And how, you know, when am I, but a lot of the things that you were kind of walking through, I immediately was able to get my role and what things, you know, what was really frustrating about it and what I would say to myself. So I thought it was, I found it interesting that it was really easy for me to be able to kind of go there.
That's great.
But thank you. So I'm going to use that.
You can absolutely steal it. These are some meditations that are in a lot of different arenas. And I'll talk a little bit about the science behind it in a second.
I was just going to say, it's interesting. It's interesting because when I'm working with teenagers, I'm always saying, speak to yourself as if you're your best friend. And I never do it for myself in that same fashion. And so as I was visualizing it, it made me take it to another level where I can use it with the children and with the teens to say, to actually speak it to yourself. You're encouraging yourself. You're your cheerleader. And so being able to have them actually settle to visualize it would actually take it to another level for them as well, I think.
Great. So great. No problem. All right, so in the interest of time, we're going to keep going, but just to talk a little bit about this. So what we did was there are a couple of meditations, and you can find them online, and you can definitely email me about resources. There's what we did at the beginning was called a self-inquiry meditation, where you kind of look at yourself and you are kind of becoming more aware of aspects of yourself and how they impact you. What I did is I just adjusted it specifically for salient parts of your identity, which I believe is something that's really important. And so that was the first part. But the second part is a self-compassion meditation. And this is actually very effective. There's a recent study, and I forget exactly where it came out of, but it found that when you are talking to yourself in third person, it lights up some of the same areas of your brain that light up when you're altruistic, when you are trying to give to someone else. And it really can reduce stress. It also lowers levels of stress. And so I'll be honest, I talk to myself in third person all the time. and it really does put you in a different space because you become both, like you said, your cheerleader, but also your best protector. I've had many situations where, you know, I would just say like, Isaiah, you did the best you could and I'm proud of you. I will literally tell myself I'm proud of you for how hard you worked at this. And it really does put you in a position where you're not impervious to what happens around you, but you are coming from a strengths-based perspective to think about things as accurately as possible, because that's what we're trying to do in a lot of the work we're doing. We're not trying to create rose-colored glasses for everyone to see everything as perfect, but we do want them to see it a little bit more accurately, because trauma, extreme stress, these can distort our perceptions of the world and perceptions of ourselves. And so we want to get people more in tune with these things. So these are, you know, pretty quick exercises that we encourage educators to think about, to consider integrating as a part of starting class and helping the students better manage some of their behavior. So that's one tool. Now, let's talk a little bit about self-soothing. Now, we get the information about the world and what we're threatened by from our senses. The reason why our sympathetic nervous system, which governs this fight, flight, or freeze response, goes off is because we're getting information from what we hear, smell, touch, and it's being converted in our brain to make a decision about how we respond to it, right? If you smell smoke, you think it's fire. Or maybe your mama can't cook, and it's just bad food. But either way, you think of something based on your previous experiences, right? And so, or dad, moms and dads can cook. When we think about this, though, what's really important to understand about the body is just the way the sympathetic nervous system is activated. Like Dr. Easterbrook talked about, the parasympathetic nervous system can be activated as well. And this is the part of our nervous system that calms us down, that helps us be able to regulate when we start to feel emotionally overwhelmed, when we start to feel physiologically overwhelmed. It's one of the reasons why kids who are experiencing, who are on the spectrum, you know, they might get disorganized because it's too much sensory information that is overwhelming them in some way, and so they'll get a weighted vest to help ground them. If we're able to soothe our senses, which is something we learn as children in healthy environments when our parents coddle us or when they rock us, then we're better able to manage kind of the stress that's around us. And so part of being able to understand self-care is to be able to help educators and whoever we're working with have more quick access to tools that help them soothe their senses. So in a lot of classrooms, we talk about having things such as comfort zones or safety zones where kids can work with Play-Doh or they can do things related to smell lavender, to calm themselves down. And so in case you aren't aware yet, this workshop we're doing is kind of a trick. Yes, we're talking about self-care in schools, but we're talking about your self-care too, because you really have to model these things. So here's what I want you guys to do. I want you to look at these five areas of the sensory inventory and self-soothing inventory, and look at what are the ones that help you soothe the most, help you think about it. So whatever paper you're working on, and actually, I would like for you guys to get in a small group. Find three or four people around you, and I want you to talk with someone about how you use your senses to soothe yourself. Take about one more minute to wrap up. I forgot I'm still on. Yeah. it definitely can be. And, that can be definitely something that's an active way to kind of manage sensory overload or to release energy. But, more of this is kind of thinking about tools that you can bring in into the moment. And like when I was talking about the comfort zone or safety zone, things that you can put in there. Yeah. All right, let's come back together. So this isn't an exhaustive list at all. And there was a question that came up around, is exercise a part of self-soothing? And absolutely, this can be a coping strategy if it helps someone kind of manage their behavior. But part of what we're thinking about here is, what are tools that we can put into kind of a kit that someone can have access to, whether it's in a school setting, whether it's something that they carry with them, and really being able to calm down the senses in some way, which can sometimes be a little different than some of the coping strategies. But of course, the overall goal is when someone's triggered and when they start to see these early warning signs, what can we do at that moment to de-escalate them before they go into this alarm or crisis mode? Sometimes we call it survival mode that they're experiencing from being triggered. So really quickly, I'm not sure if one or two people want to share some or a question that they have. Go ahead.
Well, My question is, what do you suggest for teachers to do if they need to attend to a child that maybe is getting, you know, too activated to prevent the acting out, but at the same time they have a whole classroom? So my question is, what can you do to motivate a teacher when they are not very eager to do that? Because the answer I get is, I have a whole class to manage.
Yeah. So really important question around, what do you do with the teacher who's unmotivated? Report them to the principal. No, I'm joking. Don't report them to the principal. All right, so here's a couple of things to think about here. Teachers many times feel overwhelmed because they have so many tasks, so many responsibilities. And usually when I go in schools, they want formulas for how they deal with their kids. They don't really want principles on what I need to do. They want to know exactly what they need to do. And so here's a couple of things I would recommend, maybe not in that moment per se, but how to deal with kids who are escalating as a whole. I generally talk with them about how to talk to kind of the survival mode brain versus the thinking learning brain. And so I showed you guys in the previous presentation that survival mode brain, and that's pretty much the lower part, the part that's activating, the amygdala, limbic system, that whole part that gets emotionally activated when someone's triggered. And one of the issues is that educators, and I think a lot of people sometimes, don't realize that when you're talking to, when someone's activated to that point, the goal has to be to communicate, my goal is safety. And when people start to talk about rules, when they start to talk about consequences, they're really talking to that thinking, learning brain, that executive function part of the brain, and they're not talking about safety. And what that is doing is just escalating the situation. So part of what you can do in these situations when someone is escalating, that survival mode brain is being activated, are a couple of things. One is having access to, you know, some of these self-soothing resources that give them a timeout to be able to kind of regulate themselves in some way. The other thing is to give very simple choices. One of the things that can happen with a lot of our kids is that we go back and forth with them about this thing we want them to do, when if we gave them a choice between two things that really don't matter and gave them a sense of empowerment, it would diffuse so much of the situation. So, you know, say for instance, kid says, I don't want to do this stupid paper. And the teacher, you know, if they're aware that, okay, this is kind of that emotional part of the brain that's starting to get activated, and they might not be able to hear me, you say, look, you can either start from the top of the paper or the bottom of the paper. It doesn't really matter to you, but having these simple choices prepared can go a really long way in being able to manage the behavior in that moment so that the kid doesn't escalate. And then, you know, some other things that teachers really can do is preparing for transitions. I mean, I think that that's a huge piece, and we're all very aware of that. I mean, that's part of the reason why I even transitioned you guys. You got a minute left. Like, what if you were like, I'm about to find the most profound self-soothing strategy. I'm like, shut up. It's time for us to come back together, right? It's unsettling for you. And so being able to help educators think through planning transitions, agendas, all of these things can be triggering for kids. And so, you know, that specific instance, I might not be able to resolve it in that moment if that kid is escalating to that point. But those are some things the teacher can potentially put in play to kind of start to de-escalate the situation. All right? No problem. So anybody want to say one or two self-soothing strategies that they were aware of, or one that even wasn't on the list? Knee jerk? Nature. I was like, all right. So soothing. What else? Yeah, it's powerful. It's powerful. You know, when I was working in detention, one of the things the officer did, he always cleaned the floors because it was like this lemon smell, and it really calmed them down. They really felt, I don't know if it's the chemicals or just actually the smell of the lemon, but it really calmed them down a lot. I'm looking for my, okay. We only have a couple of minutes left, so let me get through these next couple of slides really quick. So here's kind of, I generally take a micro and a macro approach. Macro approach is, how do you deal with systems as a whole? How do you consider what's needed within a system? And micro is what a lot of us do, the clinical work, the kind of day-to-day routines. From a macro perspective, part of what we want to do is we want to have an assessment of what's going on with the system as a whole. At the National Child Traumatic Stress Network, we're currently in the process of developing an organizational assessment to better assess how schools are addressing issues around trauma. But there are other tools out there that you might want to explore. There's a tool called the ARTIC that was developed by the American Institute of Research. It stands for Attitudes Related to Trauma-Informed Care. It can be adapted for some settings. There's also another kind of trauma-informed assessment that's available through another organization. I can definitely let people know kind of some of these. It's a trauma-informed care, organizational assessment of care that is also available as well. And if you Google that, you'll be able to find it as well. But these are two tools that don't map. It's actually the Association for Homelessness. I'm blanking off the top of my head exactly the organization, but it's again a broad trauma-informed tool that looks at organizational assessment. And these things can be adapted for schools. They can be adapted from some of your settings. But what it does is gives you an opportunity to periodically assess whether your agency or whether where you're working, the school, is trauma-informed. From an individual perspective, I already told you about the ProQual, the Professional Quality of Life. That's another great tool. But the other piece is to develop non-punitive supervisor protocols to debrief after stressful school events. What we find in a lot of schools, a lot of justice settings, even child welfare settings, is that when something goes wrong, people are like, whose fault was it? And the supervisors are thinking, whose fault was it? And really, when you have a trauma-informed approach, you're really thinking about kind of what happened to the kid or what happened in the situation to trigger the kid. And again, being able to be aware of, did we miss some of these early warning signs? How can we recalibrate what's happening? And then also think about the wellness of the staff worker who is impacted by this. Of course, there may need to still be some punitive measures, but this isn't the sole reason why the supervisor and the youth connect. And this is very different because, of course, in our field as clinicians, supervision is never punitive. It's really about growing and learning, but this isn't the case in other professions. And so being able to impart that on people in other professions can go a long way in helping them create a trauma-informed system. And then creating an effective feedback loop. So this is pretty much being able to better understand and explore issues around trauma within the system. And so I know I've been in some systems where they have electronic formats where they can document some of the things that set kids off, some of the early warning signs, whether it's a safety plan that they're developing, and even a self-care kit for staff. All these things can go a long way in really supporting staff. And so these are just some of these strategies. I forgot I had the slide, so I guess I didn't have to say all that. but yeah, these are some of the organizational strategies that you can consider. These are some of the individual strategies that you may want to consider in terms of being able to have an organizational approach that really addresses some of these issues. I have about a minute left. So what I want to do lastly is I want to tell you about one other concept. And this comes from the program I mentioned earlier that me and my team developed called Bridge Trauma-Informed Culturally Responsive Program. And it's the RAVE approach. And what we look at is how can we really take the things that are happening with us and really be able to affirm and to use a strengths-based approach. And so it begins with being able to reframe the stressor. And this reframe is really expanding how you think about trauma and how you think about some of these, not just trauma, but the stresses in your life. And this is something that research has shown time and time again that changes the way your relation to stress. Part of what Dr. Easterbrook mentioned with the make stress your friend is pretty much if you interpret what's happening around you as you're excited for it, like the bodily things that are happening, you're excited for it instead of stress, it'll actually change the way you approach it. Being able to reframe and include some of the positive aspects of the stressor. And then affirm important aspects of your identity that are connected to the stressor. That's kind of what we were doing with that self-inquiry meditation to start thinking about these things. Then what we did with the self-compassion meditation is we validated that experience. We really said, look, this is something that people go through. And we don't judge ourselves on it. And really thinking about how we can better manage some of the stress by being able to not be overly hard on ourselves. And then here's the key at the end. Empower yourself with these self-care tools and coping strategies. We know that the most effective coping strategies are active coping strategies. Active coping strategies can be broken down into two main categories. Problem-based, problem-focused active coping strategies and emotion-focused active coping strategies. The problem-focused coping strategies are really when you have situations in your life that you have control over, that you can change. Maybe your workload is too great and you can talk to your supervisor, you can adjust it, and so you say, look, I can't do all this anymore, and they take it down. That's great. But then there's other situations where you don't have control over what happens in your life, right? You want to get out of, you know, a ticket or something else that has happened. There's really nothing you can do about it. You want to change the kind of kids you work with, but you work with kids who have issues, who are hurting. And so you can't really change that. So what you adjust is kind of your expectations and how you approach the situation in the first place. And this is an emotion-focused coping strategy. And so being able to really empower yourself and understand when to use these different coping strategies can go a long way in supporting you. I had a little game. We're not going to play it. but here's some references and some my information as well. Thank you guys for your time. Just a 45-minute session, so if anyone has any questions, you can feel free to come up. I'm going to stick around for a little bit.
Hi everyone, thank you for staying or for coming back, whichever one you did. We're gonna start our presentation.
Okay, so thank you everybody for coming to our presentation on intergenerational trauma and the parent-child dyad, Fortaleciendo Conexiones Saludables. My colleague here is Michelle Mojica, MSW PCIT certified. My name is Patricia Hernandez, MSW PCIT certified and TOT. So we wanted to first ask how many people have worked with it with caregivers who have trauma? Raise your hand, please. Okay, so it's a rhetorical question, right? The majority of us, or basically everybody, has worked with somebody who has trauma in one way or another. So we just wanted to kind of give you guys a visual of why this talk today is so important. To kind of summarize our presentation a little bit, we're going to cover the definition, negative effects on caregivers we work with, and how those negative coping skills are passed down to our children, how it affects PCIT treatment, and ways to be more mindful and culturally relevant interventions so that you guys can take some stuff home, right, and hopefully apply some of these with your caregivers and your families.
So first off, the definition of intergenerational trauma. We already heard two presentations from our two keynote speakers and some of their versions. I like to describe it in the most simplest way of anyone who has experienced or witnessed trauma and they have never processed it or healed from it in any way. And this is a type of intergenerational trauma that's being passed down to the children that we're going to be talking about. Move on to the next one. So some of the examples of traumatic experiences can be interpartner violence, formerly known as domestic violence. Immigrating to the U.S., we all have heard countless stories of, our immigrant ancestors coming and the traverse that they experience, right? The women get raped. Some of the children come alone. Dehydration, malnutrition. They witness other violent crimes as they're coming to the U.S., or if the caregivers or the adults we're working with have any history of sexual abuse and other child maltreatment abuse when they were children.
Exactly. So now to kind of give you guys a visual, we're going to ask some of our awesome colleagues who have volunteered to help us with our presentation today. Christina and April, if you guys can come up, please. To kind of illustrate the negative effects of trauma on caregivers. So April's going to play the role of our caregiver, and Christina is going to be the child. So April, every time I mention one of these negative effects, I want you to pull the string, but also start walking away from your child. So irritability, so I want you to pull that string a little bit more. Difficulty self-regulating, so keep pulling, pull a little bit longer. No, it's okay. Sorry, we're like
got tangled.
So detachment, emotional and physical. So I want you to pull further as you can, right? Perfect. So we wanted to kind of illustrate visually, right? The caregiver and child detachment, it starts going further and further as those negative coping skills start to show up in the caregiver or in our treatment sessions, right? And so you see this in our deep pick sessions, where our initial assessment, even in our initial assessments, where the caregiver appears detached, just because she hasn't dealt with her own trauma and just not really in the room with you, right? You're kind of standing there by yourself sometimes because it's hard for them to talk about these items. And so we also have, right?
So, you know, we all heard of the polar extremes of parenting. So we either have the helicopter parent, and the helicopter parent is that nervous, anxious parent that's always hovering over the child and making sure that they're not going to get hurt, that nothing's going to happen to them. You know, some of the examples people have provided is, you know, they underwent this trauma, they want to make sure that their child is safe, but that overprotection and anxiety is being passed down to the child. Or the polar extreme of the parent that's so depressed and is so detached that they're underinvolved, right? They're not able to form that bond, and that's why we wanted to illustrate that.
That visual for you guys. So how this is transmitted and why these ladies are still up here, right? So now I want you, April, to grab the string and start raveling, right? Keep, and then come walking towards your child. So now what she's doing here, right, is all this trauma and all this negative coping skills, and now she's gonna dump it on her child, right? And then she just walks away, right? So now, so now we have poor Christina, right, with all these negative coping skills that the caregiver had due to untreated trauma, and now Christina has developed these as well as she's growing up because of that self-regulation, detachment from mother who's not teaching it to her. And so now she's left poor Christina with all this trauma and all these negative coping skills that then gets translated into our sessions, right, negative behaviors from the child in school, in the community, in public. Right, learned behavior responses, poor self-regulation skills, poor social skills.
And the children are growing up with
thank you, Christina.
They don't, you know, the different worldview. You know, our past presenters also talked a little bit about that. The sense that they have about the world is distorted. So you either have those children that are so, they lack boundaries, right? They lack boundaries because they don't know how to interact with others. They become very aggressive, very impulsive, or the opposite where they don't trust anyone. They don't trust anyone, so they can't talk to anyone and they can't form those positive relationships.
And I, as we were doing our research and just preparing for our presentation, I came across some information right on the article from Amy Bombay regarding transmission of knowledge and culture to our children. And so that's something that me as a parent or other of you guys can identify, even if you're not a parent, where we want to teach the other generation about our traditions, you know, in my Latino culture, or my tradition within my immediate family, and the knowledge that comes from that, the folklore, the myths, the legends, you know, all those beautiful things that make up our culture, we want to transmit it into our children, but we never talk about the transmission of the trauma, right? That's kind of like what somebody, one of the previous presentation, the ghost in the nursery, right? Something that's not transmitted, but it is being transmitted unbeknownst to the caregiver and the child, which is why this talk is so important today.
So we want to show you a video that talks a little bit more about the epigenetics. I know some of the past presenters mentioned this as well. And I feel like this TED video really does a great job of explaining the biology behind it. So we're going to show it to you, and then we'll talk a little bit about it afterwards.
Mm-hmm. Are you sleeping restlessly, feeling irritable or moody, forgetting little things, and feeling overwhelmed and isolated? Don't worry, we've all been there. You're probably just stressed out. Stress isn't always a bad thing. It can be handy for a burst of extra energy and focus, like when you're playing a competitive sport or have to speak in public. But when it's continuous, the kind most of us face day in and day out, it actually begins to change your brain. Chronic stress, like being overworked or having arguments at home, can affect brain size, its structure, and how it functions, right down to the level of your genes. Stress begins with something called the hypothalamus-pituitary-adrenal axis, a series of interactions between endocrine glands in the brain and on the kidney, which controls your body's reaction to stress. When your brain detects a stressful situation, your HPA axis is instantly activated and releases a hormone called cortisol, which primes your body for instant action. But high levels of cortisol over long periods of time wreak havoc on your brain. For example, chronic stress increases the activity level and number of neural connections in the amygdala, your brain's fear center. And as levels of cortisol rise, electric signals in your hippocampus, the part of the brain associated with learning, memories, and stress control, deteriorate. The hippocampus also inhibits the activity of the HPA axis, so when it weakens, so does your ability to control your stress. That's not all, though. Cortisol can literally cause your brain to shrink in size. Too much of it results in the loss of synaptic connections between neurons and the shrinking of your prefrontal cortex, the part of your brain that regulates behaviors like concentration, decision-making, judgment, and social interaction. It also leads to fewer new brain cells being made in the hippocampus. This means chronic stress might make it harder for you to learn and remember things, and also set the stage for more serious mental problems like depression and eventually Alzheimer's disease. The effects of stress may filter right down to your brain's DNA. An experiment showed that the amount of nurturing a mother rat provides its newborn baby plays a part in determining how that baby responds to stress later in life. The pups of nurturing moms turned out less sensitive to stress because their brains developed more cortisol receptors, which stick to cortisol and dampen the stress response. The pups of negligent moms had the opposite outcome, and so became more sensitive to stress throughout life. These are considered epigenetic changes, meaning that they affect which genes are expressed without directly changing the genetic code. And these changes can be reversed if the moms are swapped. But there's a surprising result. The epigenetic changes caused by one single mother rat were passed down to many generations of rats after her. In other words, the results of these actions were inheritable. It's not all bad news, though. There are many ways to reverse what cortisol does to your stressed brain. The most powerful weapons are exercise and meditation, which involves breathing deeply and being aware and focused on your surroundings. Both of these activities decrease your stress and increase the size of the hippocampus, thereby improving your memory. So don't feel defeated by the pressures of daily life. Get in control of your stress before it takes control of you.
Has anybody else seen this video before? No?
Okay.
A few.
Yes, we went to a training at our, we're from Starview actually, by the way, all late. And we thought that this would be a very good video to show you guys with our presentation.
So todo es una cadenita. I speak Spanish. I'm sorry for those of you that don't. You know, and everything's passed down. I know this one didn't specify much about trauma, and it just talked about regular stress, but that's the idea, right? Someone who has not processed or healed from their trauma is being stressed every day by the triggers or whatever it is that's coming up for them, and they're being passed down to the children. But it's hopeful at the end, right? Because like it said, our brain is so adaptive. It has such an adaptive capacity that as PCIT clinicians, that is the work that we are doing with our caregivers and our children and building that relationship. So we're going to talk a little bit more about how it affects PCIT treatment.
Yes. So this is kind of the effects of PCIT treatment. We're working with intergenerational trauma, caregiver and child. So basically the caregiver, right, becomes triggered in treatment. As we've seen it for PCIT clinicians, they start becoming, they get triggered, right? So they start, you know, being inconsistent in treatment. They start missing appointments, not answering your phone calls, missing appointments, not answering your phone calls, and then eventually leads to dropping out of treatment. But as we have learned, adverse childhood trauma negatively impacts coping skills. So this is where the caregiver's at. And from those experiences, right, we have this child who experienced all this trauma, who is now an adult and now a parent themselves, and experience and looking at life through a negative lens. So when they're in treatment, right, most of the time they're not really focused on, yes, I want to get my child better, yes, I want to decrease his behaviors, but their trauma is so severe sometimes, or those triggers are so strong for them that they start disassociating from our PCIT treatment. They become lost, they start looking off into space, you're checking in about, you know, how those behaviors went. Oh yeah, he had a good week, right? And you're like, okay, tell me more, right? And so they start kind of just minimizing those behaviors, which, as trained clinicians, we're trained to see these cues, these symptoms, these signs of the caregiver minimizing the child's behaviors. Anything you wanted to add?
That's good.
So how do we become more mindful? We wanted to show you guys another little clip. It's shorter than the other one, but we don't want to set it up because it's going to be giving too much away. We can talk about it afterwards, yeah.
This is an awareness test. How many passes does the team in white make?
Go!
The answer is 13. But did you see the moonwalking bear?
Who saw the bear?
Go!
It's not a trick.
So it's easy to miss something you're not looking for. A lot of the times as PCIT clinicians, we all know PCIT.
Ignore the cyclist.
Oh, yeah, it's a PSA. The PCIT model is very structured. We have an agenda. We do the check-in, and then we do the five-minute observation if you're in CDI, and if you're in PDI, you have the PDI observation as well. And then we do the life coaching, and we have a goal in mind. But kind of what we were mentioning, when a caregiver has untreated trauma, there are so many other things in the room that we're not looking for. Right, or we're not expecting, or we're not noticing because we're so focused on checking in. How was the client this week? Oh, he had difficulty with this. Oh, but this was really positive. Okay, then let's do the labeled praises on that so he can be calmer. And that's all we're doing. So we wanted to talk a little bit more about how we can be more mindful as clinicians when we're in the room with the caregivers. So Patty just mentioned some of the signs and symptoms. Detached. Not only detachment from the child, but we all know it's a parallel process. So as clinicians, the caregivers can be detached from us. Like Patty said, sometimes they're underreporting, but when we talk to the teachers or when we talk to the abuelitos or the tías, they're telling me, no, in fact, no, he had a really bad week. Or no, actually he hit his brother or he bit her so hard, it left a mark. So really, you know, taking that time of having those tough conversations with the caregivers of like, what's going on? How come you're underreporting? Or for example, when we're coaching and we line feed them a labeled praise, for example, and the caregiver doesn't do it. Really checking in and saying, well, you know, I noticed that I was telling you this, but you didn't do it in the session, you know, what's going on? So taking that time to build a rapport with the caregiver, not just on how are you building this relationship with your child, but how are you as an individual? And what are you going through this week that's affecting, you know, the parenting that you're doing? And lastly, assessing for trauma. In the intake, in the initial assessment or evaluation, I don't know, however you all call it in your agencies, we do assess for trauma, but in the child. we don't really ask the caregivers or the parents, have you experienced any trauma? Have you witnessed any of this? So really taking the time to assess for trauma in the caregivers and being mindful of all of that and having those tough conversations. Sometimes as clinicians, we don't want to hear those stories. We don't want to, you know, spend that extra time or that extra session or maybe not having that session that week of PCIT related, but really having that conversation with the caregiver, because we all know that it's very important in order for them to build that positive relationship with their child. Breaking a cycle.
Yes. So how do we break that cycle, right? We want to kind of share with you guys our point of view, right? Because everybody has a different perspective on how to break the cycle of this untreated trauma, negative coping skills, which is our intent, right, in PCIT, to make the caregiver more aware, give her those positive coping skills to kind of change and break that cycle. So we talk about culturally relevant interventions. Our experience, Michelle's and I, our agency has been predominantly working with Latino families, right? 95% of our families are Latinos, monolingual, Spanish-speaking, right? And so a lot of the time, some of this is taboo. Like, oh, I'm not going to tell you about my trauma that happened because I'm either embarrassed by it, it's untreated, right? So there's stigma behind it. You know, I'm not crazy. No estoy loca. You know, I don't need any services or therapy, right? But they're here for their child. And so they're willing to accept the child's behavioral issues or mental health treatment, but not for themselves. So we want to take time to talk about culturally relevant, you know, maybe just sitting with them and validating their feelings. You know, maybe they're, you know, they're cussing or, you know, they're talking so much negative talk about the child. But you just want to sit there and validate their feelings, because a lot of the times, right, they don't have a support system, right? Nobody to hear them out. And sometimes that's all they need, right? They just sit with them, listen to them, oh, yes, 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 you know, right? Reflecting back with the parent to kind of help them feel validated and help them feel heard. And sometimes some caregivers, that's all they need. They just need you to sit there and listen to them and just let them vent for a little while, even though, right, we're getting off our structured PCIT sessions, but at the end of the day, it's necessary for them to be more open to you as a clinician coming in and working with them, teaching them new skills and different parenting styles. So teaching some relaxation skills to the caregiver. I know that this is awesome, everything, some things that we all know, right, as clinicians, but the parent might not know that. You know, some deep breathing. She loves to listen to salsa, maybe that's what it is, right? We put some salsa on and let her just jam or dance in her seat, you know, or listening to a certain topic. A lot of our caregivers are also religious, right? They love to attend church. They love that support that they feel going to church. And so maybe identifying it that way, you know, finding a sense of support person in their family life, an aunt, an uncle, a pastor. You know, I have a caregiver who says, you know, my sense of support is my pastor, and they're going to help me with this and this and that. Besides that, that's basically herself and her children, a mother-in-law, and that's it, right? So that pastor might be very important in helping her get over those hurdles or those challenges that she and herself is facing with her children.
And then obviously finding relevant resources. We always say refer the caregivers to their own mental health, right, or their own individual mental health, but really checking in with the caregivers to see if that's what they want and if that's what they need. Some people aren't okay with attending individual therapy, so maybe finding a support group. So, for example, I have a caregiver who had past domestic violence, and she still hasn't processed it. She doesn't want to do individual therapy, but she's willing to go to a domestic violence support group. So really, again, checking in with the caregivers, because we can provide them with all that information, right? Oh, here, I found these three agencies. Call them. Go. But do they actually do it? No, they don't. So really checking in on that. And if they're not there yet, maybe legal resources. I don't know if many of you or any of you know this, and it's surprising to me to know that a lot of people don't know that there are ways that undocumented immigrants who have been a victim of a crime or who have been in domestic violent relationships, they are able to obtain what's called a U visa. It's an actual law. It's called the Victims, the Violence Against Women's Act. Look it up. Violence Against Women's Act. And you will find a lot of resources. And sometimes there are free legal resources for the caregivers as well.
And to piggyback on that, there's also free individual services, right, if they're victims of crime. And so just connecting them to these free resources, I think, is helpful. Like Michelle said, some of them don't want to do the individual therapy. maybe finding a way to kind of connect them, like our agency. We have a different program, right, Incredible Years, where the parent attends the group parenting program, right? So they're still getting a little bit of that individual therapy, right, because they get to vent with other parents about what their child did that week. But at the same time, they're getting that sense of support. And so that group experience kind of helps them eventually realize, like, you know what, I think I am ready for my own individual services. You know, my experience in group was positive. I'm ready to take that step, because it's a really scary step for a lot of our caregivers, you know, where they're coming from, or even, you know, their own parents at the time. You have your child, and he doesn't need that, right? He's just a normal child. He's you know, running around and, you know, hyperactive. You know, that's okay, right? But then the other side of it, it's affecting his academics. It's affecting his social skills with peers, right? He doesn't have any friends at school. So this is why it's so important to try to break that cycle of getting the parent involved, but also us, like Michelle said, that parallel process of involving the parent in our treatment, and also us observing that moonwalking bear, right? That those cues that we are not really sometimes, not that we're not trained for them, but we forget, you know, it's happened to me, you know, and I know that happens to colleagues, just because you're so enwrapped in making sure that we get our PCIT session done. That's why it's so important that we kind of take time away from that sometimes and just sit with the caregiver and talk, you know, how was your week? And this actually happened to me this week, which is ironic, right, where I had to stop session, PCIT session, and conduct a collateral session instead with the caregiver, because she was so checked out. And I noticed it from the beginning of the initial assessment, right, and I noticed it at deep picks, but our rapport wasn't there yet. You know, she wasn't ready to open up. And she's like, yeah, everything's fine. Marking, no, everything's not an issue. Until, you know, this week where she's like, you know what, there's this and that happening. It's been happening. It happened last month. It happened yesterday. And I'm like, okay, we're getting somewhere. And she was honest. You know, Ms. Patricia, I'm going to be honest with you. I haven't done any of the skills, right? And I can tell, of course, as a trained clinician, but, you know, on her end, you know, she's not caring. You know, I'm just somebody else in her life. She already checked out. You know, she didn't even see me this week, right? So that's why it's so important to check in with her. And after our talk, it was, okay, you know what? I'm really going to try and do the skills, because I know this is important. So this is why we wanted to do a presentation regarding intergenerational trauma and discuss these things with you, because it's so relevant and happens to us all the time in our agency. I don't know if you guys have any experience with this. Do you get anybody else want to share a story that happened to them regarding something similar? It's okay if you're shy. There's a big room.
If you're shy, imagine how we feel. the graph.
Yes. And so we kind of talked fast. We were nervous. We didn't realize it was such a big room. But created a graph, right, to kind of show that breaking of the cycle. I got a clicker. I forgot. Right, this is a cycle that we see often when our caregivers come to treatment for the first time, or maybe this is the second time, right? We have caregiver untreated trauma, which translate into negative effects on the caregiver, right? Those negative coping skills like Christina and April visualized for us up here. And the transmission of negative coping kids to poor little Christina, right? So now she's developed all these poor self-regulation skills that are translating into various areas of her life, impairing that
functioning.
Thank you, Michelle. And inconsistent in treatment, right? So those missed phone calls, those missed sessions, and now they're abandoning services because, you know, that's the easiest thing to do sometimes, is just to stop answering those phone calls, and she's gonna go away, right? We're gonna ignore, and then now we have discharged a case, right? So what we want to do here, right, is break the cycle. So we're summarizing our presentation, building the awareness, culturally relevant interventions, right? And every family is different, so every family will have that different cultural interventions or different cultural traditions in their own families, right? Some people really like to dance, and we could do a Zumba class, and oh, that's all the caregiver needs, just to do some self-care for herself, right? And now she did Zumba and she feels better, and now she's open, right, to our services. And so the rapport building, consistent participation. So maybe taking those extra 2 weeks to build more rapport, and now you have more consistent participation, which is what I'm hoping of my caregiver, right? So consistent participation, and then successful treatment completion. And so now this caregiver has built up all these positive skills under her tool belt, and her child have a very improved parent-child dyad, more relaxed, calmer, and that's kind of what we want to see, right? We want to see them getting along, and I always tell my caregivers, I want to see you playing with a child more than putting them on timeout, I want you to be having fun with them, you know, and let them know that, you know, I don't want to put you on timeout. I want to play with you, right? But this is kind of what you have to teach. Teach responsibility, teach limits and consequences so that they can go on and succeed at school and, you know, life or life goals. So this is my little, our little chart. Did you guys have questions? Like I said, we flew by this presentation. Comments? Yes, young lady
back.
So she, I don't think you guys can hear her. So she said, how do we explain intergenerational trauma to the caregiver and the child? Great question. I think it depends. So first, I think it would be, right, where that caregiver is, right? You wouldn't want to explain intergenerational trauma on your first two to three sessions, right? So from my experience, right, with my recent caregiver example that I gave you guys, I think this kind of leaves it open to now explaining some of that intergenerational trauma when she gets there. But I think that more important thing is watching and watching for those cues that she's ready, right? Because we don't want to introduce intergenerational trauma and explain to them all these things and what this is when she's not ready, right? But explaining it to them, I know PCIT has trauma blurbs. Maybe we start with those, right? Introducing those, talking about the child, right? And then eventually maybe we can lead into her talking about some of the trauma experience with her. I like to tie it in some of our sessions, right? Sometimes when we're closer to finishing CDI, when she's really close to mastery, you know. And this is why label praise is important, right? Because we want to break that negative cycle of, I know you informed me about your mom never praising you, you know, but now you're praising him and we're breaking that cycle and then kind of giving those in and out. It's kind of, I feel like, to answer your question is a little bit difficult because it depends on where the parent is at with your rapport building.
And I think also pointing out those signs and symptoms that you see, whether it is being checked out, being detached, not just from their child, but from with us, you know, but well, I noticed that, you know, I gave you this label praise to tell your child, but you didn't do it, you know, is everything okay, something on your mind? Or I noticed that when he does X, this is how you respond. Does that happen a lot at home? But does that happen with other people in your life or in other instances? So really like talking about those, you know, signs and symptoms. And then that psychoeducation, giving that psychoeducation, well, did you know that people who have suffered trauma go through this and this and that? Does that sound like something familiar to you? Does that sound like something that you're experiencing or you're feeling? And then moving on from there, again, when they're ready, when you have built that rapport, moving on from there with that of like, okay, well, then let's try to think about ways identifying those triggers, right? When does this happen? When does this come up for you? And then what can you do next time so that you can be prepared? And that's when the coping skills come in. Personal, whether we teach the relaxation skills or whether they identify their own. I always like to talk to the moms, or especially the moms, right? Because most of us work with moms. And I always like to point out, we take care of everyone. We take care of our children. We take care of our partners. We take care of our elders. We take care of blah, blah, blah. But who's taking care of you, right? When do you have time for yourself? Oh, I never have time for myself. I never do anything for myself. Well, now's the time. And I also like to do a very specific time and day of the week. Because if you don't tell them, okay, when are you going to do this? In the morning after you drop off the kids, during a nap time, or at night? Because if they don't start doing it in a very specific way, then they're really not going to do it, obviously, when they're going through that tough moment. So I always do that with them. And then when they start doing it and start checking in, and I check in with them the next week, okay, this was part of your homework practice. Did you do that relaxation skill? Did you go have coffee with your friend? Did you attend church? Yes? Oh, that's perfect. How did you feel afterwards? Oh, you know, and then reinforcing that. Or if you didn't, okay, it didn't go well this week, what happened? What was the barrier? How can you fix that for next week? Or maybe that wasn't a good time. Let's think about another way. So really, it takes a while, right? It's a long process in really talking to these caregivers. Any other questions, comments? Yeah, thank you. Thank you for mentioning that. Actually, in one of the research that we were doing, I forgot which one it was, but they mentioned that. The eco maps and the genograms are a great way of obtaining information and history, right? Because as the genograms is when you're asking about, you know, it's kind of like, I like to describe it, it's a generational tree, but you're asking a lot more in-depth and intense questions. So, yeah, definitely.
And that's a very, I think, very short intervention where you're not asking me, tell me the details of what happened, right? But scoring from 1 to 10, what was, you know, maybe the immigration story, right? The journey. There's a microphone right here.
Oh, that's why it's there. Huh.
Sorry, and I do have an Australian accent. Not that I think I have an accent. But anyway. So the sheets that I use is to identify the 10 best things that someone's ever had experienced. So when did it happen? How old were you? What was the name of it? You know, went on a holiday, 10 out of 10, whatever. The 10 worst things that have ever happened to you? You know, my mother died when I was 12 or something. Okay, mother died. How much does that worry you now out of 10? And then you just get them to do 10 of the worst things that have happened. And you do it like a shopping list, unemotional, just get the story. And are any of those the things that when you put your head in a pillow at night, bounces up and gets to you and you worry about? Or when you're on your own, you cry about? Which are the worst? So then you're actually like, just, okay, well, we can live with this. You know, how can we help you? And I do an EMDR type process that's a tapping sort of EMDR. You don't have to be the one that does it, but if you help them identify, this is the one we've got to deal with. And they've never had a chance to have anyone go, yeah, this is who I am. This is part of my story, good stuff, bad stuff. And then, because it's so tragic, they never get a chance to actually process it.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes. Yes, thank you.
And, you know, kind of what we were mentioning before, it's true. A lot of our caregivers, especially the Latinos, or Latinas, or monolingual Spanish-speaking, they've never sought out services. But now because their children are having problems, someone pointed it out to them, or someone referred to them, or they sought their own services for their child, now is the time, because they're coming in, right, to actually be able to ask them about their life story and what they went through. Thank you. Thank you for sharing that.
Yeah.
Anybody else?
Anybody else before we conclude our presentation? And then our sources. That's pretty much it. Thank you guys for listening and taking time to come to our presentation.
Yay.
Coffee break.